There are many operations that have to be executed in order to get a test from a patient to the results that is given to the clinician. And all of the aspects, all the operations that occur in a laboratory have to be reliable, and the results have to be timely in order to make it useful for the clinician and in order to make it useful in a public health setting, in a public health emergency, or in a public health response. To ensure the results are reliable and timely and accurate, there's a quality framework within which any laboratory has to operate. And so in this video, we're looking at the quality framework that laboratories, specifically medical laboratories, have to adhere to in order to meet standards or expectations. It's very easy to appreciate the impact, the negative impact that a poor quality laboratory result would have. Errors in the laboratory has costs in terms of patient outcomes. It has costs in terms of the personnel effort, the laboratory people that are actually doing the work, as well as in terms of time. Whenever you're making measurements, there is a level of inaccuracy that can creep into it. And so the challenge is to reduce the inaccuracies as much as possible. Now, on the surface, a quality system, that is 99% accurate may sound quite good because, you know, just 1% error rate, how bad could it be? But you can appreciate that depending on the numbers that we're talking about, 1% could be a terrible rate, a terrible percentage of negative outcomes. And it's not just about numbers, but in terms of how many events that a laboratory test has to go through in order to reach the final report. So from the point where the patient collection takes place, if there's patient details that are mismatched, to the point where if it's stored incorrectly before it gets to the laboratory, you can see there are multiple steps where things can go wrong. And so if it's only 1%, if the system is only 1% error, but you've got multiple steps where those errors can happen, then you can appreciate that it can have a huge impact. The laboratory is a very complex system, and this is why laboratories need a quality management system, a system that manages the quality at each step. Crucially, there should be a method for detecting errors at each point in this cycle of getting a patient sample to a report. And this is where international standards come into place. The International Standard Organization creates the framework via which laboratories can test their processes or follow guidelines and processes that would ensure quality at each step of their testing cycle. So the testing cycles are generally looked at in these terms as occurring in three phases. So you have the pre-analytical, the analytical, and the post-analytical stage. ISO is an international standard setting body. It's involved with promoting worldwide proprietary industrial and commercial standards. The International Standard Organization is headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland, but through its 167 national standards bodies, it brings together expertise to share knowledge and develop voluntary, consensus-based, market-relevant international standards. It's important to know that it's actually an independent, non-governmental organization. The standards are not just decided by one country, it's influenced by 167 member bodies, and they represent their country, so one member per country, and they contribute to developing the strategy for the standard. So for example, in America, there's just one member body, and that's the American National Standards Institute. If you're in London, if you're in Britain, then the member body is the British Standards Institution. Or let's say you're in Ghana, then the Ghana Standards Authority is the member body that's associated with the ISO. In India, your member body is the Bureau of Indian Standards. So there are many factors that must be addressed to assure quality in the laboratory. Now, according to the International Standard Organization, there are 12 essentials that we need to have in place in order to ensure that we achieve excellent performance in the laboratory. So these 12 quality essentials go from organization, the actual organization, personnel that work within the organization, equipment. When you're purchasing and stocking up inventory, you need to have a quality system around that, process control, information management, documents and records, occurrence management. Yes, when things happen that shouldn't have happened, you have to have a response to negate, to ensure that those things are not just addressed and they don't occur again. There are assessments, the quality systems that should be around process improvement, customer service, and facilities and safety. And so you just need to look at these 12 quality essentials and have a response, address it. At this one, we should give a definition of a quality management system. And so a quality management system is essentially your activities that are directed towards controlling the organization with regard, with a focus to quality. And this is a definition that's used by the International Standard Organization. And the Clinical and Laboratory Standards Institute. There are dedicated institutions that assesses a laboratory's adherence to these international standards. And so the international standards themselves, the people that write it, are not the ones that assesses the institutes or the laboratory's adherence. In Australia, for example, the National Association of Testing Authorities would be the ones that come out to your laboratory and assess that you adhere to a particular standard that you claim to be adhering to. In America, the Food and Drug Administration would be the accrediting body. And in Europe, you have the CE mark organization, the European Union, that would come out and assess your capabilities. The importance of having or addressing quality at each of the steps of your workflow in the laboratory cannot be overstated. For instance, if a sample is collected but it's not collected properly, or if in the transportation it's not stored properly, then it just negates all the effort that anyone's going to put in at the other end in terms of performing the test, in terms of reporting the results. So in summary, there are international organizations that provide frameworks for you to consider or to implement when you are involved in medical laboratory testing. So the International Standard Organization or the Clinical and Laboratory Standards Institute provides such documents. And in particular, we looked at the one provided by ISO and the specific one for the medical laboratory testing is ISO 15189. ISO 15189 recommends as a minimum 12 quality essentials that laboratories must adhere to. And these 12 essentials that manage quality for a medical laboratory, the first one looks at organization. An organization in this context is looking at management as well as supporting organizational structures. The second essential quality element is the personnel. They need to be properly trained and they must have ongoing proof that they know how to perform their tests competently. A third quality essential is equipment. Equipment can't just be purchased just because it's on sale or because it looks good. Equipment must be selected carefully. It must be installed appropriately, calibrated, maintained, and any troubleshooting and service and repair requirements documented. Purchasing and supply and inventory is a fourth quality essential. So suppliers and reagents must always be available and they must be from a quality vendor and they must be stored appropriately. The fifth essential is process control. So whether you're referring to it as your sample or your specimen, ISO uses the word sample. You need to make sure that it's accessioned properly. There's adequate information for you to identify each sample. This pillar also communicates how the sample should be collected as well as stored, and quality control is essential here. The quality control will allow you to monitor the examination phase and allow you to detect, evaluate, and correct any errors. They're particularly useful in quantitative or qualitative and semi-quantitative tests. The sixth quality essential is information management. And I know I mentioned accessioning of the sample that's collected. That's actually more in line with the information management. So that falls more into your sixth essential, quality essential. Specifically, it communicates the kind of information you need around patient identifiers and sample identifiers. The seventh quality essential has to do with documents and records. And documents and records are differentiated in that documents are written information. They can be policies, processes, or procedures, whereas records are results, for instance. They're locked in, they're not going to change, but policies, processes, and procedures may change as necessary, as deemed by the circumstances. The goal of documents and records, of course, is to allow you to find information whenever needed. The eighth essential is occurrence management. And so this allows you to identify any event with a negative impact so that you can have a response. The ninth quality essential has to do with assessment. And so this is talking about you being involved in audits, whether it's internal or external, and participating in an external quality assurance program so that your performance can be compared to that of other laboratories. And particularly relevant in this assessment phase or essential component of your quality system is to have an accreditation body come out and assess you against an internationally set standard, such as the ISO standards or the CLSI standards. The 10th essential has to do with process improvement. So there's this idea that you need to be creating constancy of purpose for improvement and improving constantly and forever. While perfection can be elusive, the goal definitely is to reach for it, to strive for it. The 11th pillar or 11th quality essential is to do with customer service. And you're thinking customers? Yes, you have a lot of customers as a laboratory. You've got physicians, patients, public health officials, community, customer surveys. These are all customers, and so your customer service need to be on point. And the 12th essential is facilities and safety. Having a laboratory safety program, making everyone responsible for quality and safety, the way that the laboratory is designed, the geographical or spatial organization, as well as the physical aspects of the premises and rooms. There's the need under this pillar to look at identifying risks, as well as ensuring that you have personal protective equipment, as well as emergency management and first aid. That brings us to the end of coverage on ISO 15189. Thank you for joining me on this video, and all the best with your work.